thank you all for coming, and I'm going to ease you in with a talk that is, well, it's probably not quite like any of the other talks because it has more fiction in it than anything you'll normally see at a software development conference. But I think it's interesting fiction, and it might provoke one or two interesting conversations and some good ideas. Douglas Adams, the British author and technologist, he has this lovely quote he once said. He said, "Anything that's in the world when you're born is normal and ordinary and just a natural part of the way the world works. Anything invented between when you're 15 and 35 is exciting and new and revolutionary, and you can probably get a career in it. And anything invented after you're 35 is against the natural order of things." So, this is me. My name is Dylan Beattie. I've been building websites since 1992. So, practically forever in terms of internet history. I'm a CTO at a company in London called Skills Matter, a Microsoft MVP. I run a .NET user group in London. I was born in 1978, so I was born into a world where the natural order of things was telephone lines existed. Home computers had kind of just been invented. The Apple II was taken off. We had 8-bit machines you could actually take home, so that the days of mainframes were behind us. Between the ages of 15 and 35, for me, we invented basically all of the technology that most of us in this room use all day, every day to do our thing. The World Wide Web was invented. It's actually on my 16th birthday, some guy called Jeff Bezos put a post on Usenet saying, "Wanted programmer to help develop an online bookstore," which is what became the first version of what became Amazon.com. Some things invented after the age of 35 for me, and therefore against the natural order of things, are the Apple Watch, fidget spinners, and the Wi-Fi connected toilet. But so the point that I think Douglas Adams is trying to make is that all of this technology we're surrounded with, all these things that we sort of take for granted, we kind of have this idea that we forget all of these things. They started out as prototypes, really clunky, high maintenance, one of a kind, bleeding edge products that were picked up by early adopters and they didn't really work. And then over time they get improved and they get refined and they get rationalized until you go through this evolution. And the things which are kind of finished when you're born, they're just part of the way the world works. The things that you get to watch evolving, that's the cool tech. That's the stuff that you can get into and you can contribute to that process of invention. You can be one of the innovators working on that. And the stuff that's getting invented, once you think you've got a handle on how this works, when new things come along, it can be a little bit kind of unsettling and frightening. And it's very easy to think that there is some kind of Darwinian survival of the fittest, survival of the best solution. That all the technology that we use every day, it's like that because obviously it was the best possible answer. That's not true. That's not even close to true. So much of the technology that we use today exists because of one decision or one meeting, one stroke of luck, one missed flight. There are all of these tiny little details which have become kind of turning points, pivotal points in the development of the technology, the internet, and the World Wide Web that all of us use. And so what we're gonna do today is we're gonna rewind right back to the dawn of the computer age, and we're gonna run a little history lesson. So, in the beginning, there was the mainframe, a computer so powerful, Thomas J. Watson, who was a research fellow at IBM, he thought one day the world might need 5 of them. We'd have one of these on each continent, and that would be enough to supply all of the computing power that was necessary anywhere in the world. He was wrong, obviously. I have more computers than that in my pocket. But, over the next couple of decades, these mainframes turned into microcomputers, turned into mini computers, turned into portable computers. Computers and networks, they made their way out of these laboratories. They made their way into offices. They made their way into homes. They started taking over the world to some extent. And the key player, the people who absolutely dominated the computer industry in the 70s and the early 1980s, anyone want to shout out who it was? Big Blue, IBM. They dominated, they literally owned the entire computing industry, pretty much lock, stock, and barrel. There was almost nobody else. It's hard to imagine now, even you think about a company like Apple, who have this massive market share and massive presence, compared to IBM back in the day, Apple's domination of the modern computing industry really is not a big deal at all. And IBM had realized that the next wave of computers, if they wanted to consolidate their hold on this market, they were going to need to sell computers that anyone could go and buy in a store and take home and, or take to the office and work on. And so they came up with the IBM PC. Now, the interesting thing about the PC, the radical departure that IBM made when they invented this, is they didn't manufacture all of it themselves. Because they were used to, they made their own circuit boards. They designed their own protocols. They built their own hardware. They built their own connectors, plugs and sockets and things. But with the PC, they were in a hurry and they needed to turn something around quickly. So they just bought off-the-shelf parts. They got completely standard, you know, serial bus. Okay, we'll get one of those. Parallel port. We can buy one of those. Microprocessor, we can get one of those. Operating system, we'll buy one. And we'll talk in a moment about who they bought it from and why that proved significant. Because they went to who they thought was the best software company in the world in 1981. Now, while they're working on this, there's a thing called ARPA, the Advanced Research Projects Agency. And they've got this crazy idea of connecting computers together. Now, this is actually a hand-drawn map of the entire ARPANET as it existed in the 1960s. Now, by the early 1980s, we'd ratified some of the protocols which, you know, still exist today. TCP/IP, in 1981, they signed that off. So we had IPv4. We had a way of addressing machines. TCP/IP gave us a way that networks could communicate with other networks. We had a way that, you know, this university could talk to that university, could talk to, you know, this research establishment, could talk to this company. So all of these different networks became what we know as the internet. That all took place in 1983. SMTP had been ratified, so people working at all these establishments, they had a way of sending mail, of sharing ideas, of collaborating and developing the way that the internet was going to work. And once all these protocols had been ratified, people started adding machines. And back in the early days of the internet, one of the biggest challenges that they faced is when you add a new machine to the network that wasn't there before, how do you know about it? How do you find it? How do you address it? They say there are only two hard problems in computing science. One of them is cache invalidation, and the other one is naming things. So let's talk about DNS. Now, previous to DNS, if you added a new machine to the network and you wanted the rest of the world to know about it, you would get on the phone and you would call Jake, Elizabeth Feinler, who worked at the Network Information Center at Stanford, and she maintained the hosts file. Anyone here got a hosts file? I probably have five in my pocket. Well, that used to be a file. It was a single master file that was maintained at Stanford. And if you wanted to add a machine, you had to ring her up and go, hey, we've got a new server, we got a new VAX or a PDP or something. And you'd tell them the network address, and they'd add it to the file. And then maybe you'd get a copy by FTP, or next time one of your engineers was at Stanford, you'd ask them to bring back a copy of the host's file on tape. And, you know, eventually the whole thing kind of propagated out. But, you know, it had some drawbacks. You couldn't add two machines at the same time because Jake only had one phone line. You couldn't add machines on the evening. You couldn't add machines over Christmas or at the weekends or during Thanksgiving because there was nobody in the office. This is actually a snapshot of what that original host's file looked like. This was not going to scale. You know, the internet was starting to grow rapidly. They needed a better solution, and so they got in touch with this guy, Paul Mukhopetras. And there were about half a dozen different proposals on the table, you know, sort of thick engineering, you know, proposal-type specification documents for replacing DNS. Now, I don't know about you, but if somebody gave me six thick engineering specifications and said, we need you to go through all of these and pick the right one, I would probably do what he did, which is to throw them all away and start again. He did. He chucked them all out, and he basically single-handedly created DNS, this massive, high-availability, distributed database of resolving host names to numbers to IP addresses, which has stood the test of time. It's a phenomenal piece of engineering. You know, DNS is an incredibly flexible, powerful system. And it has been running ever since. It's one of the key technologies that made the internet and the World Wide Web, you know, possible on the scale that we see it today. And then this guy comes in, Tim Berners-Lee, whose job title is web developer. I love it. Scott Hanselman has this thing about Tim could have been the web developer. He is just web developer. Tim is at CERN, the European Research Center in Switzerland. And he's playing around with this idea because what a lot of people have noticed is we've got email. So all these scientists around the world, they can communicate with one another immediately. They can send messages backwards and forwards. You can exchange files in real time. But then when you've finished a piece of research, you have to print it in a paper journal. And it goes through a peer review process. And the whole thing is very lengthy and antiquated and involves lots of printing and marking things up using LaTeX and all kinds of archaic things. And Tim is thinking, maybe we could use the same technology that powers the internet to publish things. Maybe there is a way we could put documents on the internet somehow and share them with one another. So he writes up a proposal, information management, and he sends it to his supervisor at CERN, and it comes back with one comment written on it, just says, vague, but exciting. So Tim starts developing this idea. You know, he comes up with three, there's actually three key pieces of technology that he created. One of them was HTTP, which was the protocol for communicating between the clients and servers. One was HTML, the markup language. Anyone know what the third thing Tim Berners-Lee actually invented was? URIs, URLs. It doesn't seem like, I mean, they're so ubiquitous now, it seems funny to think someone actually sat down and invented the URL. But before that, if you wanted to access a file on a server somewhere on the internet, you had to read the manual to work out how to get there. Because if it was available via FTP, you used one set of tools with one set of standards and one set of details to get it. And if it was available by Telnet or Gopher or, you know, bulletin board system, there was no consistent way of saying, the thing I want is on that server, available on this port using this protocol at this address and this path. So, you know, he borrowed ideas from DNS and file systems and all kinds of things and came up with the basically the protocols which were the backbone of the web. Now, I studied computing science at Southampton in the UK, and one of my professors was also working on hypermedia in the early 1990s and came up with a system, completely different way of thinking about hypermedia. This is a screenshot that I found of it. This was a system that they called Microcosm. And the reason I want to present this, it seems kind of the web now is so obvious, it seems impossible that there might have been any other way that it happened. But Microcosm had this completely different approach. Instead of marking up documents with links and hrefs and resources, the Microcosm's architecture said, well, why don't we maintain a separate set of keywords and hyperlinks independently of those documents? So all the material you've already got, all the text files and the papers and the LaTeX documents and, you know, WordPerfect files, whatever you have on your network right now, we can just lay Microcosm on top of them and it'll turn your entire corporate file system into a hypermedia link library. So every time you see a certain specification, we can just link you to that specification. And this example, this is actually a screenshot of an early prototype of Microcosm running. And you can see here, there's this available link screen, which just says, here's a document, here's a piece of media, you know, here's an image that we brought up in a separate viewer, and here are all of the links and contexts and things that are available. So this, other than the fact it's quite funny if you talk to this guy, the person who invented this, about the history of the web, he's like, yeah, we were right there, and then we were presenting at this conference, and this guy Tim was sat next to me, and he got up and presented first, and as he was presenting, I realized he was probably going to win, which I think is a, you know, a gift for understatement. So we've made it this far. Tim Berners-Lee is about to invent the World Wide Web, but now,
you unlock this door with the key of imagination. Beyond it is another dimension. A dimension of sound. A dimension of sight. A dimension of mind. You're moving into a land of both shadow and substance, of things and ideas. You've just crossed over into the Twilight Zone.
So, we're at CERN. It's 1992. Tim Berners-Lee is sat in his office, and he's coming up with names for things. He has this set of protocols and ideas for sharing hypermedia on the internet, and he's thinking, I should call this the World Wide Web. And then, by a fluke of coincidence, he's been typing www on things, and one day, the network stops working, and someone phones him up, and he says, yes, it's at www, and he stops, and he thinks, that sounds kind of dumb when you say it out loud. Because no one had ever said WWW out loud before, and he thinks, that's an acronym that's longer than the thing it stands for. World Wide Web's actually easier. Maybe the World Wide Web is not the best name for the system I'm working on. So he thinks, maybe we could call it the International Information Interchange. Maybe we could call it the Multinational Metadata Matrix, MMM. You know, how about that? He starts playing around with ideas. He has some conversations with some of his colleagues. They come up with the idea of the global repository of interlinked documents, something that they're going to call the grid. This kind of catches on, you know. Sounds good. People are like, all right, the grid, we can get behind this. He starts looking at the protocol, inspired by relational databases and the patterns that already exist for manipulating data. He comes up with the first proposal of the hypertext transfer protocol. It has four verbs initially. Select allows you to retrieve a piece of information from a remote server. Create allows you to publish. Remember, his objective here, this isn't supposed to be a passive read-only medium. He wants a way that people can publish and share what they're doing with the entire world. He comes up with update for the inevitable changes when someone reads your essay and go, that's not how you spell that word. He comes up with delete for the occasions when you want to remove something. They're bouncing this idea around. Someone says, you know, we might actually be able to do more with this than just reading and writing documents. Maybe we need a kind of, you know, a general purpose verb to say you want to interact with a resource somehow. So they come up with submit. There's a question mark over that. They're not sure in version one whether this is gonna fly, but they go with it for now. They need a way of identifying the resources on these things. Someone comes up with the idea, why don't we call it the standard unique resource finder? This is nice because the acronym is SURF, and people start talking about surfing the grid. This very quickly catches on. You know, it's kind of a nice idea. Now, the format of these things starts off looking like this. HTTP protocol, :// user:pass, at grid.domain.com:port/path, ?? Hashtag fragment. And someone says, why are you putting usernames and passwords up in plain text on a screen where anyone standing behind you can see them? That sounds like a massive flaw. They go, okay, we'll get rid of that. We'll go grid.domain.com, yes. Someone points out query and fragment are most of the time going to be optional, so you can probably omit those in most cases. The path is not going to be necessary because in most cases, if you need to share an address with someone, you can just point them at the root node on your grid server and it'll navigate out from there. Then he decides that the // probably doesn't mean anything. He's sort of picked it up from the way file systems work, but in this context, it doesn't really mean a great deal. So it's just http://grid.domain.com. And then someone points out that because you can still use a colon to separate the path or to separate the port number, if you had something like that, that could be ambiguous between a default server on a specific port or a server named 1234 on the default port. Ambiguous resolution? Maybe. So he gets rid of the colon, he comes up with bang, HTTP bang, grid.domain.com. And then somebody has the bright idea. What if we establish a convention that if you have a server on your network whose host name is the same as the name of the protocol, you can just omit the whole thing? So any request that comes in on a protocol will do a DNS lookup for a server which has the same name as that protocol. This means you can drop another part from it. You can come up with grid, bang, domain.com, nailed it. And Tim goes to his colleagues and he says, hey. And one of them says to him, don't you think gridbangcern.org sounds a bit silly? And Tim says, you know, lucky break. We nearly ended up with http://www.cern.org. And they go, yeah. Good thing we fixed that one, hey. The next thing that he shares with the rest of his engineering team is a draft for the hypertext markup language, HTML. He puts this thing out, you know, emails it, leaves printouts on a couple of people's desks, and the first thing that comes back from every single one of his colleagues is, Tim, this is CERN. We are scientists and mathematicians. These angle brackets that you keep using, we use those to indicate less than and greater than in all of our equations. Do you have any idea how long it is going to take us to rewrite all of our papers so that the angle brackets aren't mathematical symbols anymore? Angle brackets might break stuff. This is an interesting point. So Tim thinks, okay, we have a lot of material that already exists here. It's all, you know, in ASCII format. Let's find the ASCII character which occurs the fewest number of times in our corpus of scientific papers and see if we can use that as the basis for the markup language. So you take an ASCII table, you run it through a whole bunch of scientific papers, and you come out with the tilde character, the least frequently used character of the basic lowercase, lower ASCII character set in most English scientific writing. Okay, let's take the tilde character and run with that. So, the first rule that we introduce for this hypertext markup language, two consecutive line breaks, that means a new paragraph. This means that a lot of the text files that already exist are just valid HTML without changing anything at all. The formatting isn't going to get mangled if you look at them in a grid browser. Let's come up with some ideas for markup. So we're going to need a couple of different levels of headings. So what about if we introduce a convention? You start with a tilde, that means we're opening a symbol, we're opening a markup tag. We're going to use curly braces to delimit those because there's quite a lot of editors in existence at the time on the systems people are using that are very, very good at matching pairs of curly braces. Emacs does this, VI does this, various people, Nano and Pico, have got editors that support this capability. We want to mark up fragments within the text, you know, that's cool. B, bold text, come up with some conventions. Let's look at a slightly more developed example. So, what we've got here is a document. It identifies itself as HTML, and it says that the language of this document is English. There is some metadata. This is information about the document that is not part of the document. It includes the title. It's HTML, Jim, but not as we know it. Then we have the document. This is the thing you're actually going to show to the person who's reading it. Someone originally came up with the idea of they should have, you know, a head and a body, and someone else pointed out that this is a digital format that doesn't get printed onto pieces of paper, so the idea of a header didn't really make a whole lot of conceptual sense, you know. And then there's an example in here of how we are going to link things. Somebody had this bright idea that they should use A, which stood for anchor, and the rest of the team went, what on earth does an anchor have to do with hyperlinking anything to anything else? So they went with link. So what we've got here is a link, surf, that's the protocol, grid, bang, cern.ch, hello.html. Yeah, nice and simple, there's the link. And finally, we have an example of how you can embed an image in this markup syntax. Now, these protocols get shared, they get published, they get put on the first ever grid site that ever exists at grid.cern.ch. Buzz gets around, word gets around. Very, very quickly, lots of companies jump on the bandwagon. They start developing tools to work with this. In the United States, at the National Center for Supercomputing Archives, they build a product called Mosaic, NCSU Mosaic. It is the first grid browser that really gets traction. You know, it's graphical, it has a certain amount of capabilities. It runs on the X11 desktop, which is ubiquitous at this particular point in history. And you know, it isn't long before the big players, the big corporates, start to smell the money and think they need to get in on this. Now, as I mentioned earlier, in 1981, IBM built a PC of off-the-shelf parts, and they needed an operating system, so they went to the best computer company in the world in 1981 to see if they could buy an OS. And that company was Digital Research. This guy, Gary Kildall, had founded a digital research software company, and in 1981, they had a thing called CPM, the Control Program for Microcomputers. It's a file system-based single-user operating system that ran on, you know, generic x86 hardware using Intel processors, and they sold it to IBM. And what Gary Kildall had worked out is that IBM had made a massive mistake in the way they'd built the PC because they effectively didn't control any part of it. And he saw, Gary Kildall saw very quickly, that if IBM were buying parts off the shelf, putting a bespoke operating system on and selling them, anyone else who had access to the same supply chain, i.e. basically the whole of the Asian manufacturing industry, and the same operating system, would be able to build IBM-compatible computers. So he did them a very nice deal. He sold them a license to the operating system and said, you can use this, you know, one-off cash payment, you can use our CPM for as long as you need to, but by the way, we're allowed to sell it as well. It took about 2 years for these generic beige clones made by all sorts of companies running CPM to completely wipe out IBM's share in this market. Now, there was another computer manufacturer at the time, but they were going through a spot of difficulty by the mid-1980s. Steve Jobs, who together with Steve Wozniak had created the Apple II, the original Apple Macintosh, the Apple Lisa, visionary, you know, brilliant, by all accounts, quite a difficult guy to work with. And in 1987, he was ousted by a hostile takeover. People bought him out of his own company, kicked him out, kicked him across the street. He didn't even pause for breath. He basically moved into a new office and he started building these things, next stations. Now, the next computer was Steve Jobs' attempt to take everything he'd done at Apple and incorporate it into a high-powered workstation system aimed at image processing, the motion picture industry, medical imaging, education, application development. One of the earliest adopters of this system was actually Tim Berners-Lee, who used a Next system to write the very first set of grid pages and grid browsers, including worldwideweb.application, the source code to which is still available and floating around out there somewhere. So Jobs has decamped. He's been booted out of Apple. He's off building these little black cube systems, which they're fantastically powerful machines, but they are struggling to find buyers for them. In the meantime, much to the consternation of the United States Department of Justice, Digital Research start talking to the WordPerfect Corporation, who are the biggest manufacturer of word processors and office software in the world at the time. They merger. They start a company called Perfect Digital. This becomes, you know, it scares the hell out of the authorities. They're basically like, we have this one company now who own all the operating systems and all of the office and productivity software. This is never, ever going to end well, you know. But eventually, you know, after a couple of years of litigation in the courts, the whole thing just sort of dies out. Perfect Digital, they have a flagship operating system, a thing called Gem, which is a graphical environment for manipulating documents and images and things on screen. It's mouse-driven. It looks fantastic. You've not seen anything like it. Gary Kildall has become the world's richest man. Gem is the world's best-selling operating system. Perfect Digital decide that they need a web browser, a grid browser, sorry. And they go shopping. They start talking to a couple of people. Now, one of the team from NCSA who created Mosaic is this guy here, Marc Andreessen. And Marc Andreessen has a buddy, a guy called Jim Clark. Jim Clark founded a company called Silicon Graphics. And these two are basically bored. Jim has left Silicon Graphics. He sold the company. He's looking for something to do next. Marc Andreessen has decided it's time to move on from NCSA and start working on his own thing. And, you know, they're batting around a couple of ideas for collaborations they could do. One of them is a browser. They're thinking they could start some kind of browser project. But then they get a phone call. Nintendo are on the line. And Nintendo say to them, you know, hey, we're looking. We got this new 64-bit console coming out, the N64. We think it would be really cool if the N64 had network gaming built into it. You know, we'd love it if people could buy this thing at Christmas, take it home, plug it into the phone jack on the wall, and play Mario against all of their friends all over the world in real time. And this sounds like a brilliant idea to Jim Clark and Marc Andreessen, and so they go and work for Nintendo in Seattle. And when they get there, they end up sharing an office with these two guys, John Carmack and John Romero. Now, shortly prior to this, Carmack and Romero had been camped out in their beach house in Pasadena for a couple of days, and as an experiment, kind of just to see if they could do it, they ported Super Mario 3 to the x86 CPM operating system. And they sent a copy to Nintendo, and they said, look, we know you've always focused on your console hardware, but we think we've worked out a way that you can run your games on these things. Imagine if you could sell illicit copies of Super Mario to everyone who's got a computer on their desk in their office that they can play on their lunch breaks and after work and stuff. And Nintendo, they see the massive potential for this to happen. They sign them up. So suddenly, you've got John Carmack and Romero, who are probably some of the finest graphics developers in the world, sharing an office in Seattle with Jim Clark, who founded Silicon Graphics, Marc Andreessen, who at this point probably knows more about grid and networking protocols than anyone else working in the industry, and Nintendo bankrolling the whole thing. What do they come up with? We'll find out in a minute. The Gem 3 desktop is taking over the world. It's on every desktop, every office computer, every laptop and portable that exists. And they are looking for a grid browser. Their early talks with Marc Andreessen and Jim Clark have kind of panned out into nothing. And somebody says, you know, I heard rumor that over at Cornell University, the librarian there, the guy who manages the library at the law school, has written a browser. He's written this thing called Cello. Now, WordPerfect have this long connection with the legal industry, because it's been the word processor of choice for preparing legal documents and contracts for years and years and years. So this looks to them like a match made in heaven. They go knocking. They go and see Thomas Bruce was his name. Go and see Thomas Bruce, and they say to him, look, we understand that you've invented this thing called Cello, this grid browser. We'd like to buy it. And he goes, brilliant. I really had no idea what I was going to do with this. I'm a librarian. I've invented this popular piece of software. I can't quite work out how to turn it into a business. Fantastic. They make a deal. They buy him out of it. They take the source code. They put it through the WordPerfect branding machine, add a couple of tweaks, integrate it into their system, come out with GridPerfect. GridPerfect is the first grid browser to come from a major corporate software and application vendor. It has a couple of innovations in it. First of all, they already have WordPerfect. They have this fantastically powerful word processor with spell check and grammar check and inline editing and WYSIWYG and all these capabilities. They plug that in, they add support for the update and the create commands in the grid protocol, and bang, you know, they've created a way that anybody with a word processor can now publish a document onto the grid in, you know, as much time as it used to take to save it to a disk. The real innovation, though, the thing which moves GridPerfect ahead of all of its competitors and changes the way the grid is going to develop, is they come up with something called secure application frame encryption. It's a variation on the grid protocol that uses secure encryption on both ends so that the packets cannot be intercepted in transit. This means, out of the box, it is secure. You can communicate with a remote server securely with no risk of your information getting leaked. This opens the door to a whole raft of applications, online payments, online email, all kinds of, you know, personal medical records, things that can now be stored online centrally, so you can access them from any machine that's running the GridPerfect browser. And it takes about a week of this before someone goes, we could really do with a programming language embedded into this GridPerfect thing, you know. It would be great if we had a way we could actually write programs instead of having to send everything back to the server every time. Now, you know, this is the early 1990s, and if you are going to embed a scripting language in a piece of software, there is only one choice. You know, there is one logical language which has already been embedded into all kinds of applications all over the world. Does anyone know what it was? Anyone use Emacs? How do you script Emacs? Lisp. Anyone use AutoCAD? How do you script AutoCAD? Lisp. AutoLisp. Yes. Lisp, the pure functional language, the prototype of Lisp, you know, the original specification, goes all the way back to 94, and it has not really varied a great deal in the meantime. You know, your father's parentheses, elegant weapons for a more civilized age, as XKCD puts it. And in the 1990s, if you wanted to get somebody to embed Lisp into a grid browser, there was only one person who you would talk to, which was Paul Graham, the founder of ViaWeb. So Paul Graham would later go on to write this fantastic collection of essays called Hackers and Painters, create a programming language called Arc. He would found something called Hacker News and Y Combinator. But at this point in history, he's still working on Lisp as a language and working on ways of using Lisp to develop grid applications. He and his team working at ViaWeb came up with this kind of, you know, this leap of insight that Lisp is based on a style of computation called continuation parsing. It's a way of taking the state of a running program, capturing it, and then executing the next sort of set of frames that are on the stack in the context of the environment you've just captured. Now, this works beautifully for the grid because it's a request-response stateless protocol. So effectively, when you get a request, what you can do is you can process that request, capture the result of that operation, and send it back to the client on the other end and go, here is the environment in which we would like you to execute the next iteration of this journey. So it avoids the need for things like, you know, session variables and persistent storage. You need a bit of validation. You know, we're using the safe protocol here to encrypt this environment so that you can't tamper with it, everything's signed. But it's a very, very natural fit. Continuation parsing programming with the notion of request response and statelessness works absolutely brilliantly. Now about this time, Sun Microsystems have been working away on something called Java, which is their amazing, better than C++, and it runs everywhere, and it's fantastically brilliant. And they get word of what GridPerfect are doing, and they come knocking, and they go, hey, please put Java in your grid browser. And GridPerfect go, no, we don't think we need it. And they go, well, maybe you could just rename something to sound like it, like this Lisp thing you've got. Maybe you could call it Java Lisp or Lava Script or something. And they have a big, long meeting. And Paul Graham goes down, convenes a team. The people from Sun Microsystems are there. The people from Perfect Digital are there. They all sit around a table. Over the course of a very, very long afternoon, he explains to them why this is not going to be necessary. He explains there is absolutely no reason to incorporate Java into this, and there's no reason to even kind of dabble with any kind of co-branding. It's going to confuse the hell out of people if we have Java and then we have Java Lisp. You know, that's going to cause confusion for decades. Let's just not even go there. And then they're like, but what if we put Java in the language? He says, no, you're missing a crucial point here. The thing about Lisp, the really powerful thing about Lisp as a language, is that every Lisp expression is also a Lisp program, and every program is also an expression. It's a language that basically can be used to rewrite itself. You can take any expression that you've created, turn it into code, and interpret it. You can take any piece of executable code, and you can just persist it, which means we can send little tiny fragments of half-executed programs backwards and forwards. We don't need to worry about things like binary format serialization. We can literally take a program on the server, get halfway through running it, freeze it, send it to the client, and continue running it there. It's using a thing called S expressions, which is the basis of Lisp language syntax. This kind of blows people's minds. Suddenly, for the first time, they really see the potential of having a pure functional language with continuation passing and S expressions running on a network protocol like this. They say thank you, but no thank you to the Sun Microsystems people who toddle off back to working on, I don't know, the network computer probably. Does anyone remember that? The thing that sat on top of your TV that was going to replace computers the world over? And it's done. Hyperlisp is the language of choice. It's embedded in GridPerfect. It's going to be running everywhere. Anyone want to see what it looks like? So here we have an HTML document, something relatively simple. We're going to do the simplest possible. We're going to do hello world. We're going to get the grid browser. So it's just going to pop up an alert that says hello world. And it looks like this. So Lisp works backwards. You read from right to left because it uses prefix notation. We have an operator here, alert hello world. That is just a native instruction that says to the grid browser, hey, say hello world. Then we want to bind that so that it knows when to happen. And the way we are going to do this, we are going to use a lambda. Lambda is how you construct function references in Lisp. So we are going to take the document. The document here is what's called a symbol type. It is a reference to an individual entity that exists as part of the runtime. We are going to capture the load event of that document, and we are going to bind it to a lambda that just says, hello world. It's nice, you know, simple, minimal, relatively elegant. There's very little syntactic crossover between the HTML syntax and the Hyperlisp syntax here, which I think is kind of nice. Let's have a look at a slightly more evolved example. So this is where you can start to see some of the, you know, the pure kind of beautiful synergy between these two languages. Now, because Lisp uses prefix and postfix notation for its arithmetic operators, we can put punctuation inside our symbol and our variable names. So this convention, which is rapidly emerging about using hyphens inside the names of identifiers for document elements, we can use that directly. We've got element IDs here, so that main form maps directly onto the form that's in part of our document spec. Postfix notation, variable names can be hyphenated. We got a greeting span. Lambda callbacks, so we get asynchronous behavior out of the box. We don't have to implement anything special with it. What we're basically doing here, grid is a reference to the network runtime that's baked into the browser. We're going to invoke the submit method of that grid. We are going to send some information. So what this code basically does is a very simple, enter your name here, press go. We're going to send that back to the server. We're going to retrieve some kind of response. We're going to display that on the screen. It's all asynchronous. It's done using lambdas, continuation passing, same language on the client and the server. And this is all going on in about 1994, which I think is pretty cool. Now, while all this excitement is going on, the marketing teams have been working overtime. Perfect Digital have got something big up their sleeve. There's a massive press release. There's a massive launch ceremony. And they announce Gem 95, the shiniest operating system that the world has ever seen. They get the Fab Four, the Beatles, reunite for the launch ceremony of this. They use Get Back as the theme music for the launch because the GridPerfect browser with the back button they think is the user interface paradigm that's going to define the next decade of computing. It is a massive, spectacular media event. The press go absolutely nuts for it. It looks like they're about to take over the world. And meanwhile, things are not going terribly well. It looks like Gem 95 has been the final nail in Apple's coffin. The company, you know, since Steve Jobs left in the 80s, Apple has been really, really struggling. They've been trying to build a new operating system. It's not going anywhere. It's been 2 years. They don't have a working prototype, let alone a releasable product. They sit down one day, they're like, look, what are we going to do? And someone says, what if we bought Next and got Steve Jobs to come back? And everyone says, that is the dumbest idea anyone has ever had. Steve Jobs is never coming back to Apple. Look at how we treated him. What else have we got? And someone says, well, those two guys who left a couple of years ago, they went off to found their own operating system. You remember them. They started the BIOS. What turns out, they're trying to get out of the hardware market, and they're looking for someone to take over running the software for it. Now, BIOS is a completely greenfield operating system. Two former Apple engineers, they started this out of the box as a native OS for doing high-performance multimedia applications. They, for a while, are building their own hardware, B-boxes. The problem they found is that the markup on the hardware is so low that they're not making any profit. All of the innovation now is going into the operating system. It's got some really cool features. It's got multi-streaming and multi-threading support built in, so you can have simultaneous multimedia streams with minimal CPU impact. It's got some really, really interesting hardware APIs for interfacing with extended devices and things. They do a deal. Apple go knocking. Apple say to BIOS, we'll buy you for $100 million in cash and stock. The deal is done, and Apple unveil their new line of hardware, the banana boxes. It's yellow. Everyone goes, it's yellow. We thought computers had to be beige, apart from those weird black ones that Steve Jobs is over there trying to sell. Now, one of the few things that BIOS didn't have was a grid browser. And they have the, you know, the quintessential question in software engineering, do we build one or do we buy one? So they go shopping, and they find, of all people, the Norwegian telephone company, Telenor. Because somewhere in a research lab at Telenor, there's a bunch of engineers working on something they call Opera, which is a prototype high-performance grid browser. So Apple come knocking, they say, look, we got these amazing shiny new yellow computers, we got this fantastic new flagship operating system to go with it. We would like to buy your operating system. You know, we've got the banana boxes, we've got the BIOS, we'd like to buy Opera, we'd like to rebrand it as B-Link. So they do, the E immediately goes missing, it becomes known as Blink for the rest of computing history. And Apple are back. You know, they roll this thing out, it's a pretty big success, you know, not great, but it sells respectably, it grows slowly. The Blink browser supports the SAFe protocol, it supports Hyperlisp, it supports all of these languages and concepts that are making the grid such a compelling application development platform. Lots and lots of people start writing lots and lots of content. And it turns out that people are giving away grid space for free, left, right, and center. You can get it on the cover of a magazine, you get it free when you buy a machine, you get it free when you buy an operating system or an upgrade. The grid is rapidly filling up with crap. And a couple of people have tried to solve this in various old-fashioned ways by curating manual indexes and publishing books which tell you which grid pages you should go and look at. None of it really works until Larry Page and Sergey Brin, who are working out of a garage in Stanford, have come up with this neat idea. It's a thing they call backrub. It's an algorithm that will look at pages, and then it'll look at other pages, and it'll go, well, if those pages are pointing to this page, maybe this page is important. And if all those pages are pointing to that page, and that page is pointing to this page, maybe this page is very important, and that page is quite important, and those pages are not so important. And, you know, they think this could be a really, really neat idea. They think this could be a good way of assessing the veracity and significance of pages and nodes that have been published onto the grid. So they prototype it, and they come up with that, like, what are we going to call it? Someone says, you know, this thing is going to be huge. What's the biggest number you can think of? And one of them says, well, you know, my kid was in school today. He learned about something called a Google, G-O-O-G-O-L, which is like a 10 followed by a million zeros or something. And one of the others goes, brilliant, see if we can get the domain name. So they type Google into something, and it gets mistyped, and then it gets auto-corrected, and it comes out as Goggle. Search the grid using Goggle. Now, it's a fantastic, brilliant piece of technology. The problem is, they don't have any idea how they are going to make any money out of search, because there's no money. Well, you know, all the other search providers are plastering advertising left, right, and center all over all their pages. Goggle do not want to get into plastering advertising. They like the minimalism. They like the way that this interface looks. You know, it's clean, it's simple, it's straightforward. They are casting around, you know, they're looking, they put the company up for sale at one point. They're looking for around about $1 million. And nobody's interested. They're like, why would we buy this company that just runs search and is not ever going to, you know, there's no business case here. And then they get a phone call. It's Steve Jobs. He's working on something, something very big, very secret, and he might be interested in acquiring Goggle's algorithm. So we don't know exactly what happened next. The minutes of these meetings have never been released. But what happened after that would become the stuff of industry legend. April 1999. Most of the computer industry is going crazy about the millennium bug. You know, at the stroke of midnight at the end of the year, all the Soviet nuclear missiles are going to launch themselves because of computer bugs, and we're all going to die in a screaming fireball. And this journalist, these journalists, they get to work one day. They find a black envelope on their desk. That's it. Just no address label, just this black envelope. They open it up, and inside is a card. It just says, "Get ready for the next generation." It's got a date, May the 4th, and an invitation to the San Francisco Civic Auditorium. Now, immediately, everyone thinks, May the 4th, you know, this must be a Star Wars thing. Lucasfilm put out a statement saying, there will be no Star Wars prequels. The rumors are unfounded. Why would anybody even do that? So, the date causes all sorts of excitement. On the day, the auditorium's packed. It's just before 9 o'clock in the morning. Steve Jobs gets up on stage. And, you know, he talks for a little while. He talks about innovation. He talks about hardware. He talks about the grid, all the things that have changed, the way people now are living their lives in a completely different, a connected way, a digital lifestyle that, you know, no one really thought about. Then he reaches behind his podium, and he pulls out, is that a laptop? It's called the Nextbook. Nobody's ever seen anything quite like it. You know, it's less than an inch thick. It's a single piece of aluminium, anodized, this lustrous black color. There's no floppy disk drive. There's no CD-ROM drive. People are like, hey, how do you get things into it? And he's like, no, this is the first computer that is network native. This is the first machine designed to run and live on the grid. Nothing on it but a pair of USB ports and a headphone jack. There's this buzz, you know, everyone is kind of clamoring to get closer. Then about 20 plants in the audience, they reach under their own chairs and they pull out 20 Nextbooks. They open the screen, and it's streaming the content from the stage live onto it wirelessly. At this point, the journalists are so excited they forget they're journalists. They start kind of elbowing each other in the face and clamoring and trying to get close and get a better look at one of these. You know, the press coverage of this is absolutely stunning. Takes over the world. The Nextbook is the most powerful laptop anyone has ever seen. You know, it's 333 megahertz processor, 5 gigabytes of flash drive storage, 64 megs of RAM. It's got the Next Step operating system. It ships with a thing called the Nextender. It's about the size of a paperback book. That's the thing with the CD-ROM drive that you plug into the wall. And that's the thing which bathes your entire house in wireless network signal so that this thing can work from wherever you are using it. And, of course, baked into this, there is a grid browser, Nexus. Nexus is an iteration on the original Next Step, the original World Wide Web dot application. The code that runs Nexus is the DNA of the origins of the grid, the very, very first browser created by Tim Berners-Lee at CERN all those years ago. Steve Jobs is back with a bang when the dust from the millennium bug settles and everyone wakes up and realizes that there were no missiles and we weren't going to die. The computing industry looks like this. We've got Next running the Nexus browser on a version of the Nextup operating system. Apple running BIOS with Blink running on it. We got Gem 95 and Grid Perfect. Hyperlisp running across all of these. Down in one corner, we got Sun Microsystems going, Java, you forgot Java. Please, please love us. All right, we'll run Hyperlisp as well. And the Solaris workstations ship with a version of the NCSA Mosaic browser, a Hyperlisp runtime, which has Java support, which no one ever really uses. Meanwhile, what's been going on at Nintendo? Now, there was an initial flurry of excitement when Marc Andreessen and Jim Clark and the two Johns got together in that office, culminating in the release of the best computer game of the 1990s, Super Mario Quake World. But after that, everything went a little bit quiet until around about 2003, 2004, there started being this buzz that Nintendo were going to be bringing out something interesting, something unprecedented. Finally, December 2003, Nintendo unveil the platform that is going to change the world. It's a thing they call reality. It's the metaverse. It is William Gibson's Matrix from the Neuromancer books. It is a massively multiplayer, completely immersive, 3D interactive environment. It is everyone's chance to create their own 3D avatar. It's built on the networking code from Marc Andreessen, the founder of NCSA Mosaic. The 3D graphics engines and hardware created by Jim Clark based on his time at Silicon Graphics. Level design and avatar design by John Romero. Graphics programming by John Carmack. Some of the finest minds in industry, bankrolled by Nintendo, one of the biggest and richest companies in the world. It is literally the dream of every kind of teenage computer hacker realized and visualized and brought to life. And, you know, it's kind of hard to imagine a world without it, isn't it? Imagine that. Imagine there was no reality. Imagine there was no grid perfect. Imagine there was no hyperlisp. Imagine we didn't have continuation passing, you know? Imagine that the banana box was never released. Imagine a world without next books. I know, it's kind of weird, isn't it? So, how much of that is true? Well, obviously none of it, but how close were we to that version of history? So, 1981, IBM really did go and see Gary Kildall from Digital Research to buy an operating system to ship with the IBM PC, and he was out. He was off flying in his plane because it was a nice day, and IBM went, all right, who's next on the list? And it was this guy. By the way, in our history, Micro-Soft is a little vendor based out of Redmond who make Hyperlisp editing tools. They turn over about $500,000 a year. You know, it's a good living for Bill and Paul and a couple of their high school friends, but they never really amounted to anything. Now, I mean, there are two versions of this. There's the kind of urban legend story that Gary Kildall was off flying in his plane. There's another version which says they had a bunch of meetings, but they couldn't come to a deal because Kildall was asking for too much and things. But, you know, there were genuinely meetings. IBM were going for CPM first. That was the thing that they wanted. HTML. The version that Tim Berners-Lee proposed that all of us work with, you know, every day was based on a thing called SGML, which was a standard generalized markup language. But that wasn't the only markup language that he could have based it on. This is, what is this, LaTeX? Yeah. So this is LaTeX, which existed and was widespread throughout the industry. And it's kind of surprising, you know, a lot of the people who would have been in those initial focus groups were people who knew how to write LaTeX documents and had probably never worked with SGML because that was a publishing format. So I'm kind of curious, you know, the other thing, there was rich text format. That existed around the same time as well. So it could so easily have been one of these that inspired HTML's markup syntax instead of lots of angle brackets and what would eventually become XML. Paul Graham really was doing continuation passing. ViaWeb was eventually sold to Yahoo. It became the Yahoo Web Store. He really was writing web servers in Lisp in the early 1990s. He really was using continuation passing to handle request response and stateless persistence from one step to the next. Lisp really was the embedded language that was used in things. It's used in Emacs, it was used in AutoCAD. You know, in my first job, I was doing desktop support for a bunch of building engineers, construction engineers. And there were people there who were Lisp programmers who could, you know, code circles probably around anyone in this room. And they didn't even think they were programmers. They were just really, really good at designing buildings in AutoCAD using this scripting language that was built into it. Carmack and Romero really did port Super Mario Brothers to the IBM PC. And they sent a copy to Nintendo, and Nintendo sent it back saying, this is absolutely brilliant, and if it ever sees the light of day, we are going to sue you so hard it won't even leave a crater. We have no interest in running Super Mario on beige office computers. Nintendo are about making family-friendly entertainment for the home. Go and do something else. And of course, the two Johns went and founded id Software. You can actually, if you look closely here, you see that underneath the fish on this is a real screenshot that John Romero shared on Twitter last year. And you can see Ideas from the Deep, which is where id Software got its name from. And you know, they went on to do Doom and Quake and all kinds of, you know, fantastic programming stuff. And this really did nearly take place when Marc Andreessen and Jim Clark, who of course, you know, in the real world, they started Netscape. That was their venture that they did. But it was touch and go. They were like, well, we could go and do the gaming network for Nintendo, or we could go and start our own web browser. And you know, it probably came almost down to the toss of a coin. I think the thing that clinched it in the end, from what I've been able to sort of read about it, was they just didn't think that the quality of the phone connections was good enough for the kind of network they wanted to build at the point they wanted to build it. So they said, well, we'll go and do this web browser thing for 6 months and see what happens. And of course, 6 months of Netscape, Marc Andreessen's on the cover of Time magazine with no shoes on and a massive pile of money. And you know, the rest is history. Cello was a real product. It was a real web browser for Microsoft Windows that really was written by the chief librarian at Cornell Law School. This is a real thing. You can still find the code for this. BIOS was a real operating system, really founded by two former Apple engineers. Now, you know, what actually happened, as you all know, is that Apple bought Next. So the origins, the kernel for OS X was what code that used to be in Next Step. The Cocoa operating system and windowing library, that used to be Next Step. Steve Jobs came back. The iPad, you know, the old blue iMacs, the iPhone, all these innovations happened. But I still find it astonishing that actually happened. you know, given the what you read about Steve Jobs and how what a lovely, forgiving man he was by all accounts, getting kicked out of his own company and then coming back and turning their fortunes around, that's really, really kind of weird. Google really was up for sale for less than $1 million. They had no idea how to make money out of it. They, Lycos were in talks, and Google wanted $1 million, and Lycos were only offering like 700,000, and eventually Google kind of went, all right, we'll let it go for 700K, and Lycos went, actually, no, we're not interested anymore. We don't think your company's ever going to amount to anything. And you know, the last bit, so this is where the whole kind of idea for this talk came from. This is an excerpt of an interview with Tim Berners-Lee from 2009.
Let me ask with one, start with one historical question, if I could. If, again, you know, we live in the world in part you created the architecture for. If you think back to the start, if you had it to do all over again, would you change anything? What would you have done differently?
It's a good question. And of course, you can never ask what would have happened if you'd have done something differently. There are some, I mean, there's some simple things. In fact, when I designed the URI, the URL, this thing which starts http://. The slash slash was to indicate that we are actually starting at the top, that we're not starting down at the next slash, but the colon in there as well. It turns out people never use the slash slash without the http colon. It turns out, really, if you think about it, you don't need the slash slash. I could have designed it to not have the slash slash, and boy, now that people all over people on the radio are calling it /. People are having to use that finger so much. Think of the amount of, you know, of print now that would have been saved if we wouldn't have saved if I'd just removed the double slash. But there you go. You know, you can't. It seemed like a good idea at the time.
It seemed like a good idea at the time. So, and yes, my fictional history of the World Wide Web ends there. Obviously, all of that is, or most of it, is my own invention, apart from the couple of details at the end. Please do not go out and misrepresent anything here that I've made up as, I went to NDC and they said that Tim Berners-Lee was going to use rich text format, because that's not what happened. But you know, hopefully that has given you kind of just a little bit of insight into the little decisions, the turning points that have shaped the web and the platforms and the protocols, the technology that all of us live and use every day. And just a little glimpse of how different it could all have been. Thank you very much. We do have a minute for questions. I will make up the answers. Any questions? Yes.
Is there something you'd like us to take away from this?
Yeah, Lisp. Learn it. It's good for you. It'll change the way you think. And then if you ever get Lisp and a time machine, please go back and reinvent. no, I guess the kind of one of the takeaways, we agonize over these decisions. And actually, what I think we've got in there are some decisions that I think were probably wrong, but we've managed to make a huge success out of all of it anyway. So when you get into we need to choose a format or a protocol or anything, really, you know, try and do a good job on it, but don't get paralyzed by indecision and overwhelmed by choice overload. You know, pick something, go with it, share it, let people work with it. It will evolve. You know, the world runs on JavaScript now. JavaScript was invented in 10 days by one person trying to meet a deadline. It's by far the most widely adopted and successful programming language now in the history of the world. It was never designed to be that, you know, but because of its kind of popularity, it just got this positive feedback effect. Would Brendan Eich have done stuff differently if he'd known how big it was going to be? He probably would never have invented it at all. You know, if you'd said to him, well, you've got 10 days to build a programming language that 15 years from now is going to run literally every single device on the entire planet, he'd probably have gone, find someone else. But you know, he's like, well, I got 10 days, I got to hit a deadline, but also let's try not to get this too badly wrong. And incorporated a lot of really good ideas like prototyped inheritance. It took the programming community a long time to catch on to the potential of some of these ideas. And some of them, you know, like the implicit scoping in JavaScript, I think has turned out to have been a mistake. But yeah, you know, you've got to make a decision. The worst thing you can do is not make one, because if you don't make one, you can't do anything with it. So yeah, if I had one takeaway, it's don't worry too much about getting it wrong, because somebody's going to find a way to make it work anyway. Any more? All right, thank you.